present, we've been listening to the some suggestions from the American Iron and Steel Institute about the steel companies. They are in very poor shape. They have been very good at investing in the last few years in modernizing their industry, but they sort of got caught up in the last year or so with the ability to follow through on their original plans. They've come up with some suggestions in the areas of trade, taxation, that antitrust, joint venture possibilities that we've been studying. And we've been having kind of talking back and forth here just before you came. We were on trade. That fits in with your plan, sir. Could keep on.
I think so.
Good
to hear, because I know this is a great, certainly great concern to use for yourself, sir.
Dave, since trade is your most important subject, why don't you capitalize on
that? I'm telling you where to stand.
Can't push it.
Secretaries Donovan, Heckler, and Bell, ladies and gentlemen, good morning and welcome to the White House. I'm glad here as we all gather that we're in the one room in the White House that's got a Nobel Peace Prize on the map. Sausages and laws, you should never watch out to one of them being made. The appropriation bill I am about to sign represents an exception. The bill appropriates substantial funds for valuable human services, including some $13 billion for the Department of Labor, about $15 billion for the Department of Education, and some $72 billion for the Department of Health and Human Services. While the overall funding increase in this appropriation has been kept under tight control, the bill provides the highest funding level in history for the basic income support programs on which many Americans depend. In the Department of Health and Human Services, for example, cash assistance, medical aid, social services, and other basic support programs receive 5% more funding than they did last year. It's a substantial but responsible increase. And we've also been able to incorporate increased funding for educational aid and services to the handicapped. This bill represents proof that government can be compassionate without being extravagant. The bill also represents something of a historical landmark because it's been 5 years since any president has signed a bill like it. Since 1978, the Congress and presidents have been unable to reach agreement on funding for federal human services, so until today, those services have been financed not by appropriation bills, but by continuing resolutions. These disagreements over funding have taken place against the backdrop of a larger struggle, a struggle that transcends partisan politics and involves every American, the federal government's struggle to regain control of its own budget. In the mid-70s, federal spending lurched out of control. Neither the Congress nor the President seemed able to hold down the upward spiral. In the 10 years before we took office, federal spending tripled. It became clear that unless something was done, our nation would move from a costly private economy with all the marvelous benefits of enterprise and innovation that entails to the grim stagnation of an economy where the government controls most resources. Our administration took office determined to get the budget under control, but to do so with compassion for all Americans. We cut taxes, We passed tax indexing. We cut the growth, the rate of growth of federal spending by nearly 40%. Now, those steps brought order back to the economy and cut inflation from more than 12 to under 3%, restoring economic opportunity for all. And let's remember that while many government services are important to our nations and the needy, in the long run, no government program can help Americans in need as much as a healthy and growing economy. Again and again, our administration and responsible voices on the Hill have urged the Congress to join in our effort to bring the budget under control. Though far from perfect, this appropriation bill proves that both the executive and legislative branches of our government now recognize the overriding need for fiscal restraint and can work together to achieve it. I know a big bill like this takes thousands of hours to put together, and I want to thank the chairman of the Appropriations Committees, their staffs, and those concerned in the executive branch for all their hard work. This bill is a big step forward. Their time and effort represent a genuine service to our nation. So I thank you and God bless you, and now I'm going to see if those pens are right. I'm going to only write one word. It is done. Everybody heard of the Democrats on Lebanon. I still think that there are a few questions that you might have and that we can answer here this morning. And I'd like to start off with asking Secretary Schultz to speak first on the subject. As you know, they're meeting in Geneva now in Lebanon. We have hopes.
Mr. President, it's hard for a Marine to speak about Lebanon right now without, on the one hand, a sense of pride, and on the other, a lump in the throat. Nevertheless, we are there for important purposes connected with our overall objectives in the Middle East, as well as in Lebanon. I think in terms of immediate things that aren't just repeating what everyone knows, the talks have gotten underway in Geneva. The various leaders check their pistols at the door. They have started. It's a tough situation. However, it's the first time in decades that they have done this, and there is going to be, we expect, a real effort at national reconciliation. I'd like to point out one thing that is not noticed very much, but which I think is of tremendous long-term importance, and long-term importance to us as we think about the role of our own forces there, and about the day when they may return. And that is the development of the Lebanese Armed Forces, their regular army. It's been a long time since the central government of Lebanon has had any armed force of its own. And with the help of our military people, that force has grown from a standing start 8 or 9 months ago to a force now of some 30,000 or so. It is the one multi-confessional organized unit in Lebanon. And it works. It's done well. And since the ceasefire, it has added to its ranks. It has continued to recruit. It has received additional supplies from us and from the French, and it's gaining in strength. And I think that's an underlying thing. It takes a while, and it'll continue to take a while, but that's a very important development to keep your eye on, because it has a great long-term significance. I know that you have a big agenda. I'll stop at that point and turn to questions or whatever you'd like.
Well, or would you like to, I'm going to call on Captain General to complete it, and then Paul, would you be available for anything that you might have here? Cap?
Sure. Mr. President, we had in no tactical change in Beirut, and no incidents, fortunately, overnight or in the last couple of days. Sniper fire continues to come in since the bombing and disaster, which only a week ago, although it seems like a couple of years. There have been two more wounded, but not seriously, and returning to duty. But the sniper fire does continue. There has been a new rifle company added for additional protection and fill out the really relieve the people who have been working in such a terrible pace in the last few days to try to uncover the remaining bodies or see if there were any wounded still there. And the final count is at 231 with 69 wounded. And that is believed to be final in the sense that the rubble has been as thoroughly examined as possible at the moment. The Marine group that has completed its work in Grenada is on its way to its original mission, and which was to relieve in a normal rotation the group that is in Lebanon now, and that will take place about the middle of this month. And at that time, the additional rifle company that has been put there to relieve the people who are performing all of these special duties will come out also, so we'll go back to our regular strength, which will be about 1,600. And General Kelly testified yesterday. He testifies again today, and he and I testify tomorrow on the various events and the security precautions. And some of these have been outlined in a statement, opening statement that he gave to the Senate Armed Services Committee yesterday, and it will be the same statement that he used in the subsequent testimony, John, today and tomorrow. And basically, this traces the chronology and difficult part of the mission there, which is to keep the airport open and enable them to act civilian government, the Lebanese. There are problems because when the airport's opened or closed is under Lebanese government control. And the desire, of course, is to have the maximum, was to have the maximum access. The period of time between the time that this suicide truck crashed through the first marine gate and thereby gave the first evidence of what it was about, and the time when the explosion went off, 6 seconds. And the truck was fired upon, but of course it's totally and completely obliterated, so we have no way of knowing whether the effect the fire had any effect or not. But it was fired upon, and it was in that range of time that this whole incident took place. And there are a number of things that could be done in the way of trying to reduce this specific kind of incident. It's also important to bear in mind that the men were in this building because it was one of the few intact, reinforced concrete solid structures that was standing. And the principal threat up until the time this happened, of course, was the fear of sniper fire and machine gun, mortar, automatic weapons. And the building did give great protection against that time. It did not give protection against the suicide mission. Otherwise, Mr. President, there's been no basic change in the tactical situation there. Jeff, do you have anything on that?
Well, as you said, Mr. Secretary, that John Kelly has returned from his trip out there, and the deputy commander of the U.S. European Command also visited to look at new security measures that could be taken. And I want to tell you that that's just a the last in a long series of teams that have been sent out there to look at what security measures could be taken to increase the security of the Marines. And that, everything that they've recommended is being implemented, with the exception, well, I shouldn't even say the exception, but the other thing that hasn't been done that's being examined is looking at moving to another position. Is it possible for us to turn over the airport to the Lebanese Armed Forces, move to another position, or move the ships? And what's the impact on our mission of doing that?
Mr. President, I forgot to add one thing. We have called a full investigation within the Department of Admiral, retired Admiral Long, formerly Commander-in-Chief of the Pacific, is heading that. And they will get to work starting today. And we'll have a full and complete report their findings just as quickly as we can make it, and it will be constituted as an independent body that will examine the whole thing.
Mr. President, may we address questions